As we continue our study on St. John Paul the Great's Theology of the Body, let's take a look back at what we've learned so far. In our design, God had a plan for the body. We can use our bodies to express God. In order to understand our purpose in life, we must look to our origin, history, and destination. In the beginning, there was just God, and through an exchange of love, God the Father begets God the Son, and their communion love explodes to create the Holy Spirit. This model was then designed into our bodies, as through marriage, a man and a woman's powerful exchange of communion love also creates, this time, a child. So, in our world today, there are two ways to model this love, one being in marriage. And the other way is when a single person models this exchange of love and becomes in communion with God. So God's two design plans are marriage or celibacy. Unfortunately, the devil has his own plans, and he has set out to attack God. Since he cannot destroy God, he goes right after the next model and attacks the creating power of love. Thus, it's the devil's plan to destroy the purpose of sex and the family. As a result, St. John Paul the Great has designed his own plan to defeat the devil. His plan focuses on understanding the purpose of sex, love, and the family. Thus, the battle wages on, and it's our goal to learn and understand our faith. Continuing our study, we go back to those three terms, and we continue to focus on our history. As the devil worked to destroy the design of the family and love through sin, chaos and confusion spread throughout the world. God had other plans. Since mankind was unable to live the right way, he sent a helper to show them the way. Through the act of the incarnation, God sent a savior to our world. The word incarnation has the root word carne, which means body. A body was entering into the world to save it. Thus, God was using Jesus to become the new Adam and to show the world how we should live. He showed us how to help, forgive, and how to love others. And it's the power of love which we'll focus on now. Do you remember the first time we saw this action in our origin? Yes, it was with the arrows. Let's take a greater look at what's happening there. Anytime that you have love, it's the process of giving away, also known as self-giving. Let's use a basic 10 frame from math as an example. Before you can self-give, you need to have something to give away. And when you give, you empty yourself out in some way. In the process of self-giving, you also open yourself up to receive as well. So the church teaches that when you give, you also receive something in return. But the church doesn't stop there. When you self-give, you not only receive the amount that you gave, but you can also receive much more. Much more than what you are physically capable of receiving. But since the spiritual life is invisible and goes beyond the physical, there is no limit to the spiritual amount you can receive from giving. So, this is what happens when we self-give. God will fill us with even greater things, past what is physical. And this is what is known as grace, which is God's life in us, which is found in all the sacraments and whenever we imitate an action of God. Now, we can go back and look at our bodies and how Jesus showed us how to live. Jesus' purpose on earth was to go out and self-give himself. As St. John Paul the Great said, in the exchange of love, something is created. Remember when we said, Jesus is the new Adam? Do you remember when God put Adam into that deep sleep and created something out of his side, his rib, the creation was his bride, Eve. Well, he does the same thing with Jesus. When Jesus was on the cross, he died and fell into that deep sleep. While this was happening, something was being created out of his side, his rib. Do you remember the crucifixion story? When the soldier took the lance and speared Jesus in the side, well, blood and water flowed out. From this blood and water, something greater was created. It was Jesus' bride, and it's through this bride that blood and water created the church. From Jesus' rib and side, the church was designed. And this is why we need to always look at the cross, as many things were created through it. Another creation from Jesus' self-giving was the virtues. And you can see how it's formed through this new exchange of love. You may have heard of them before, but a virtue is the disposition to do good and perform good habits. In the church, we have two major groups of virtues, the cardinal virtues and the theological virtues. The virtues become examples of what can happen when we self-give. All we have to do is look at our saints and find the leaders of virtue and self-giving. And so, we can make it our daily goal to give ourselves to others. Now, you can see what happens when you use virtue in your life. Your actions cause goodness, which leads to a moral life. And, according to the pillars of the Catechism, which is the blueprint of our faith, your actions help to lead the third pillar, the moral life. When we do use the virtues, we will do our part to join in the battle to defeat the evil one and spread good throughout the world, as we use our bodies to express God, which is the root of St. John Paul the Great's program, Theology of the Body.